So we are becoming ever more integrated with technology. It's everywhere, but technology is really what we make of it. And we should really bring it to the next level. And I think the way we can do this is ask the question, how can technology learn from us? And the way it can learn from us is that we can teach it. We can teach about humanity. And by doing so, it can make us more human. Lack of understanding, knowledge, and empathy is the root cause of many human problems. And I believe we can use technology to increase some of that understanding. We can get knowledge from places like the internet, but the internet in itself is not inquisitive. These are the Blab droids, and they're robots created to learn about people. And they do this by going around and asking people questions, as most of us do when we want to learn. And you can see they're very cute and made to be very friendly, because if you want to have a relationship with a robot, it better be pretty nice. So next you'll see a couple examples of the Blab droids asking some people some somewhat difficult questions.
If you could give someone any gift, what would it be?
Give my mother the gift of not worrying about me before she dies. And she wants me to lose like a ton of weight and get really, really healthy. And she needs to see that before she dies for her to feel like I'm gonna be okay when she's not here. And I wish I could give her that, and I'm not positive I can. You asked.
If you died tomorrow, what would you regret the most?
I switched out her shampoo for a Nair hair remover when she wasn't looking, and clumps of her hair fell out. I felt that she deserved it, and it's very much so justified. And I would do it again to her in a heartbeat. I still don't like her.
So these are the types of things that you may not tell a person who is coming up to you with questions, but the robots, in fact, got those answers. So the idea is that these robots will become a tangible manifestation of cloud intelligence that can both learn and teach. And like I said before, the internet in itself doesn't necessarily learn, but these robots can be made in a way that we want to interact with them on a very high level. Think of them as if you had a dog in your house that asked you questions, but you could also ask it questions. So how do we make something like this happen? Well, the first step is making it. And we partner with a few people like Dragon Innovation to do manufacturing in bulk to form a company around this. The idea is that these robots will connect to the cloud through your cell phone using Bluetooth. So we're all carrying around these devices in our pockets that are basically very smart computers, and they also have network connectivity. So we could do things with a robot like ask it simple questions, you know, will it rain? And the robot said, well, yeah, it might rain, you may want an umbrella. But asking it more difficult questions like, are we alone in the universe, or things of that sort, need a bit more of a human touch that things like Google or Wolfram Alpha or things of that sort may have a hard time answering. And one way to do this is use cloud knowledge and cloud intelligence. So say you have a question for the Blab droid, and it isn't one of the simple things like, do I have a meeting scheduled for tomorrow? It might say, well, gee, I don't know, I'll ask my friends. So the robot then accesses the cloud and talks to all his other Blab droid buddies and asks them, hey, does your human know something about this person's question? And they may say, yes, let me contact them. And you can see some of these guys are a little busy, but a couple of them may have a good idea. So these people can tell the robot the answer either by looking up, or maybe they're an expert in the field. And that knowledge can be returned to that robot. And at the same time, that knowledge can be saved online in this sort of emergent intelligence where, okay, the robot couldn't find it through traditional means, now it's stored that human knowledge. So imagine like a robot asking grandma what her favorite cookie recipe is. That's something that might have been lost to time in the past, but by using these social interfaces, that can be stored. And there are obviously things right now where you can talk to your cell phone and talk to other things where you can ask it questions and it'll give you answers. But the primitive parts of our brains don't think cell phones are alive, even if they have voices, because they're not persistent beings. They're not objects that always stay alive in a way. where a robot in itself is a physical form. So even though it is connected to this cloud intelligence, it's something that our brains perceive as alive. And the way we want to do this is that we want them to be very fun and playful. So you want to talk to them, you want to converse with them, not only asking them things, but also having them with you as companions. So in the future, we think that these can create until now, undocumented part of humanity. So a lot of this oral tradition, a lot of storytelling, which has been integral to humanity, has been kind of lost in the internet age, where these can start getting some of these ideas. Reduced cost of cell phones will allow these to permeate in more places. And a new breed of social knowledge through sharing and interacting will allow us to connect to people that may be culturally dispersed. There are lots of problems to solve, obviously. Technical issues such as voice recognition and data storage and that AI in the back end. Issues such as privacy and security, because obviously you're telling the robot things. Other problems such as, will personal robots be adopted? So that's more of a social question. To trail off here, I figured we'd have one example. So imagine you asked your robot, you know, what created the moon? Who better to answer than someone like Chris Hadfield, an ISS astronaut? So let's see what he has to say.
What created the moon?
What created the moon? The moon was created about 4 billion years ago when a huge rocky early planet slammed into the Earth, something about the size of Mars, crashed into the Earth like two big wet pool balls, billiard balls, slamming into each other and ripped a big section out of the Earth that went off like a big glob into space and started orbiting the world and slowly cooled, and it got further and further from the world over the billions of years until it finally coalesced and looks just like our moon does today. So truly, the moon is like the daughter of the Earth.